Good evening.
Good evening.
It's great to be able to be here and worship on a Sunday evening. It's been a little while. We've had some snow. We've had some other things come up. And I've been waiting to preach this sermon for a couple weeks, so I hope y'all are ready to hear it, because it is ready to go. We started a series on really Timothy and Titus, and we went into Philemon, and then I decided we'd go on into the Thessalonian letters. And we're in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18 this evening. And the title of this evening's lesson, as you may have noticed, is I'll Fly Away. Now, whenever Paul was writing to the churches at Thessalonica, he dealt with many different things, but one of the things we see present in both of his letters to the church of Thessalonica was a discussion about the end times, what would happen when Christ came back. What would happen to those that had already died, had already gone asleep, as he puts it. And we're going to be discussing a little bit about that this evening. So if you would go ahead and turn over your Bibles there to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 through 18. I'm going to have the text up here on the screen behind me. But once again, I would also encourage you to follow along in your Bibles as well. 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, with the sound of a trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore encourage one another with these words. Now from this text, there's a lot of things that we could look at, and many different directions we could go. There's a lot of false doctrine that we could dispel and expose, and there's a lot of positive doctrine that we could give light to. We're not going to make an attempt at doing all of that this evening. But I want us to notice three points. So if you don't take anything else away from this lesson, take this away, please. First, our sleeping brothers and what Paul tells us about them. Second, what Paul tells us about we who are left, those of us that are still alive when Jesus comes again. And third, how and why these are encouraging words. First, back to our sleeping brothers. Now I want to make sure I point something out here. I'm not trying to make any type of comment on sleeping as any form of doctrine. I'm sure many are familiar with the doctrine of soul sleeping, those that are vehemently opposed to it. And those that practice and believe in that, this is not all a commentary on that or anything like that. The term sleeping is often used in Scripture to describe those who are dead. It's a kind way of saying something that might be otherwise not so good to talk about. We do that as well. When talking to someone who's recently lost a loved one, perhaps we'll say it that way. I know you've recently lost a loved one. I know that your family member, he, she, whoever it might be, is now gone on to be with the Lord, has passed away. Now, would it be just as true to say, you remember your family member that died? That's dead now? But that isn't as nice, kind way to say it. So when Paul says, those that are asleep, he's trying to be gentle with those that care very deeply about them. One thing that's very obvious from this text is that the people in Thessalonica care very much about those who were Christians and had fallen asleep, that had passed on. They cared very much about them. They were worried. They were worried that those who were already asleep, that they would miss out on something. That they would not get to enjoy what others are enjoying. First, some things I want us to notice about our sleeping brothers. Number one, Jesus promised. In John chapter 11, in verse 25, Jesus made a promise. His promise was that he is the resurrection and the life, and that whoever believes in him, though he dies, yet he shall live. Jesus promised there was life to be found even in death if you believe in Him. That promise for Jesus is one that should give a lot of encouragement to us. Something we'll look at a little bit later. I don't want to jump too far ahead. This ties together too well. What kind of promise is that? It's a promise that these who have gone asleep could still have some kind of blessing to enjoy. It's a promise to those that are still awake that they need not worry about those that have already gone asleep. But not to belabor the point, to get a little further into this, Jesus not only made a promise that He would provide life even in death, but He proved this promise. He made sure we could trust His promise. In 1 Corinthians 15, verses 18 through 20, this is what Paul was saying to the church of Corinth. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Now, if you're familiar with the context of this chapter, it's often what's called the resurrection chapter of the Bible. Because in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul talks a lot about the resurrection body, the resurrection from the dead, how it's going to take place. He even gives a little timetable. And when you compare Paul's 1 Corinthians 15 chapter with 1 and 2 Thessalonians, you get a very clear picture of what the resurrection is going to look like, and the judgment for that matter, and the timetable for that. It provides a very succinct timetable. But that's not really the point we're trying to make here. During this discussion of the resurrection of the dead, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15 is, what if Christ hasn't been raised from the dead, as some of you say? In fact, they started out with, what about this resurrection of the dead? What if there's not a resurrection from the dead? If there's not a resurrection from the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. If there's not a resurrection from the dead, then we're not going to be raised. If there's not a resurrection from the dead, then those who've already passed on will not be raised from the dead. And then he goes into the implications of that here. If there's no resurrection from the dead, then Christianity loses its point, its meaning. It's worthless. It's pointless. There's nothing left to Christianity without resurrection. If Jesus had died on the cross, had been a good teacher, and laid in that tomb today, we would have no point to be here meeting together. We might as well go back to the Judaism form of worship. We might as well let the hedonists say, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you die. Because without resurrection from the dead, we have no hope of eternal life. Without the resurrection of the dead, then Jesus of Nazareth, who claimed to be the Messiah, claimed to be the Christ, would have proved himself to be a liar. Now, what Paul mentions now is that we know that Christ was raised from the dead. We know that Jesus has been raised from the dead, and that He was the first fruit of those who have fallen asleep. How do I know that Jesus is going to keep His promise? That whoever believes in Him, though they die, they shall still live. How do I know He's going to keep that promise? Because He rose from the dead. Does He have the power over death? Obviously. He's not laying in that tomb. He has power over death. In death, He finds victory. That's giving me a hope, a promise. So our sleeping brothers, Paul gives encouragement there to them that Jesus made a promise and that promise was proven. And that promise is something we can be relying on. Well, next, what about us who are left? What about us in view of the coming again of Jesus? The mystery of the rapture. Now, if you've done any study or any looking into the end times at all, whether it be from a secular viewpoint, a religious viewpoint, various Christian viewpoints, you may have come across this word before. This word rapture actually comes from a Latin word, raptura. I believe I pronounced that correct. I don't speak Latin, so you'll just have to take my word for it and give it a test run, I guess. It comes from a Latin word, raptura, which is actually a good Latin translation of the Greek word there. The Greek word there literally means the same thing, being taken up, caught up. In 1 Corinthians 15, back to this resurrection chapter that we were talking about a moment ago, verses 51 and 52, Paul tells the church of Corinth the mystery of the rapture, of the being caught up. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. Now this gets into that timetable I was talking about. Here you have the last trumpet, the trumpet sounding, and the dead rising. Not the same kind of body as before. An imperishable one. One that doesn't decay. One that doesn't grow old. One that, as the wise man in Ecclesiastes said, he said, remember now your Creator in the days of your youth, and he goes on with poetic imagery to describe the different things that happen to the body as one age. He talks about the blossoms turning white. He talks about the frailness of the bones, both in the legs and the hands. He describes how the hearing becomes more difficult as age progresses. And the whole point of that chapter being, remember your Creator in the days of your youth, because as age goes on, you lose some of those blessings you had in your youth. The resurrected body, imperishable, incorruptible, doesn't get damaged, doesn't decay, doesn't get old. And the trumpet sounds, and the dead shall rise. The mystery of the rapture, when we're all caught up to be with Jesus in the air. Sometimes people like to nitpick a little bit and don't really like to call that the rapture. I think it's about as right to call it the rapture as it is to call the assembly of God the church, because they're both derived from Latin words. Church comes from circi, and rapture comes from Latin too. So I think it fits about as well. We're going to be caught up with Jesus, and we're also going to be a part of the assembly.
You say the word rapture means raised up?
Mm-hmm. It means being caught up, raised up together. Throughout all of biblical history, one thing that really strikes out, throughout all of the things that Paul is really trying to communicate here, a focus on Jesus, a focus on the second coming of Jesus, a focus on everything that is culminating in this last day. When the blessings are received, when the time is completed, we who are left will be caught up together, and we who are left will go to God's house. In John chapter 14 and verse 3, Jesus gives another promise. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. The promise from Jesus. Not only is there life in death, but also He has prepared a place for us. And that place is where He's going to take us to. Those of us that are still alive, when Jesus comes again, perhaps it will be the very ones in this room. Perhaps it will be no one in this room. We don't know. But those that are still alive when Jesus comes again, they'll be changed. They'll be caught up in the air to meet Jesus and those that have already passed on. And we'll go to be with the Lord right then. It won't be a time of waiting. How is this some encouraging words? How can this give some encouragement? First and foremost, Jesus made a promise. Jesus promised that He would deliver something. And through His promise, we can have faith that God will deliver. Through this promise, we can have faith that He will do what He has said He would do. That He would give what He said He would give. Whenever God has given us something so great to look forward to, what reason do we have to not pursue it wholeheartedly? What reason do we have not to run full speed towards it? In Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1, it says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." That race has a conclusion. That race has an end result. This is a passage that I really love to make reference to, Hebrews 12, 1, because I love the picture that it paints. But what people rarely ever focus on is the end of the race. When looking at this passage, we often focus on the race itself, laying aside all of these weights, the sin that is clinging to us and holding us back, laying aside everything that's holding us back so that we can run. And surely that is the focus of the passage, and surely that should be our focus while we're here. But what point is it to run if you're not running to anything? What point is it to take off if you have nowhere you're going to? God has provided us a home. He promised that we're not going to be running in vain. In 1 Corinthians 15, 57 and 58, Paul said, "But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." Not in vain. You're not just running with no point. You have a goal. You have a home in heaven to be struggling forward. Encourage one another. Why? Those that have passed on, it's not that they are missing out on anything. They finished their race. They're done. They're waiting for you. They're cheering you on, waiting for you to cross the finish line. Be encouraged with these things. Don't have run in vain. Don't give up. Finish the race. One thing that always strikes me and touches me is when we have an opportunity to sing "I'll Fly Away" out of the nursing home. On Tuesdays, we go out there and we sing, several of us. While we're singing that, I can see some of the residents closing their eyes, and I can assume what they might be picturing, that they've come to the conclusion of their race, or at least nearing it. And it would seem they were so excited about the idea of flying away home to a place where they don't have the same kind of pain and suffering they might be enduring now. You know, I've seen that same song sung in very different places. I've seen it sung at youth rallies. I've seen it sung at youth camps. I've seen it sung at different congregations worshiping, different age groups. But I haven't seen the same kind of effort, the same kind of heart put into it as when we sing it out there. I haven't seen the same reaction from the people. "Hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away." But it brings a question. Will you? Will you fly away to be with Jesus forever? Will you be with Him? Have you done what it takes to reach that finish line? Or are you giving up? Are you deciding that you've been running for too long, that it's become too hard, and you're just done? You decided that what it takes to cross that finish line is just too much for you to give up, and you're just not willing to do it. If that's something that's came across in your life, then I would encourage you to change your mind. I would encourage you, please reconsider, because crossing that finish line is all that matters. Flying away to that home is the only thing that's going to matter for the rest of all eternity. In a moment, we're going to sing a song of encouragement. And as we sing that song in a moment, if you would like to recommit your life to God and ensure your home in heaven, that place that He has prepared for us, I would encourage you to do that. If you've never done that before, and if you've never made that commitment, the invitation is, of course, for you as well. If you'd like to respond to the invitation, won't you come right now? Once again, we stand and sing.